from the depths of the inhuman fish ocean all the way up towards creepy ass torture room. We want to hear your nerd shout, and today we're shouting about S.H.I.E.L.D.
The finale.
That's fair. Yeah, that's true. I know. Hey guys, it's Kevin Becker coming at you with the rest of the nerdSHOUT team. I just wanted to... Ah! That's my hand! I'm gonna throw it to these guys while I try to find... No! Ah!
Hi guys, it's Demetris Hartman, and I'm angry.
Let's talk about the show.
Hey gang, Mark Cirillo here. And Namor is pissed about that Terrigen pollution.
Hey everyone, it's Keyla Teixeira. It's really great to be back this week, and it's sad to see season 2 end. Really, really great season.
Well, this is it, guys. This is the season 2 finale of the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. after show based on the season 2 finale of Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. on ABC.
Yeah.
So, here we are. How are you guys doing? Are you okay? We're just checking in. Are you all right?
I'm not 100% all right.
I know.
I can't wait that long, man.
I know. Man, how are you doing?
I'm still processing.
I understand.
I need my S.H.I.E.L.D. fixed.
A lot happened. A lot of people died.
Oh my God. So many people died. So many twists.
So many
turns.
So let's go ahead and talk about it then, because I think I'm fairly certain that's why we're here. I'm not 100%, but I think that's why.
Yeah.
95%. Since I'm here, okay, I'll talk about it.
Okay, great. Jaying.
Holy.
Are we starting there?
We're starting with Jaying. Okay. We're going to start with our main bad guy of this episode.
Right, the female Dr. Doom. Or Magneto.
Magneto.
Yeah.
So her evil plan has come to fruition. She has started a war between her and S.H.I.E.L.D. And there was a lot that happened with that. We got to see Sky fight May, which was the best thing ever.
May took her down when it came down to hand-to-hand combat.
As we knew she would.
Down.
But
yeah,
my favorite part about that was just like May trained Sky, so every move Sky did, May was just like, no, I know what that is.
That was the crazy thing.
Like, May was totally stationary,
just being like, boom, boom.
I don't want to hurt you.
It was so easy for May to be like, hey, I'm not gonna do it.
It was pretty great.
But then Sky force pushes her.
Yeah, exactly.
She's like, you're not welcome.
Fine.
Get the hell out.
Can't do
that. It's like so many Star Wars references, pretty much, kind of.
We're gonna discuss it later, though. I love Star Wars.
It's insane.
But one of the big things that came out of Jaying's evil plan that got to a lot of us was the death of Reyna.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, I know that somebody disagrees with
somebody.
Me. But I thought it was a beautiful end for Reyna because
she
found that acceptance to herself that she's been looking for since before we met her. And she managed to pretty much put in motion what saved everybody.
Yeah, she was able to redeem herself.
She literally sacrificed herself for the greater good because she knew that was how it had to happen because she'd seen it all. Like, she knew. And that was amazing.
Yeah,
it was a full revolution for her character to finally be good.
Yeah.
And it was like her salvation. Now she was okay to die because she'd sort of redeemed herself.
That's true.
It was beautiful.
It was a new chapter in Reyna's life. And that is why, for me, I didn't want her to die. Like, I wasn't ready for
her. It would have been nice to see her as, like, a good guy.
It would have been, but
to lead the... Yeah.
To lead... Well, she said, like, I'm not the
she
one
She wasn't
going to
be the one that could save him. She knew.
And she's like, I have to deal with it.
As much as I would have loved to see Queen Sky and Lady Reyna, like, always arguing over, like, no, you can't have
bickering.
The dinner on Thursday.
Yeah. No, but, like, I guess she would have, if she joined S.H.I.E.L.D., she would have totally overpowered S.H.I.E.L.D. as well, because she is a clairvoyant. Mm-hmm. She would have had the ability to kind of precog everything that's going on
true.
In the world and save everybody. There would be no need for S.H.I.E.L.D. or other S.H.I.E.L.D. agents, essentially.
Yeah.
Oh, so but you think she had to die?
I understand it. I understand why in the television format she had to die and like
die
at the end of her arc. But I'm just so sad because she was such a good character. Her acting was was tremendous in this episode. Like,
yeah, really great.
She was so good. I took a step back while I was sitting there watching the episode, and there's like that scene where it's her and Sky just really getting into it. And I'm just kind of like taking a step back, and I'm looking at, like, you're a human being that's wearing so much prosthetic makeup right now. You got thorns and shit coming out of your face. You look ridiculous, right? by any other standard. But you're making it seem so authentic, mm-hmm. so real, so beautiful. I feel for every single moment and for every single thing that you're saying. And that's what made me say, like, no, she's like such a high class, like such a high caliber actress, in my opinion, from what she was able to do with this part. That's why I was like, oh my god.
I didn't want to see her go either, but I think that's why they did it now.
Yeah,
because totally. If we had all gotten to the point where we were just like, yeah, she could die, scoobly doop. Like, it wouldn't have meant anything.
Yeah.
Keyla.
Awful death, damn.
I'm looking at you, Keyla.
Yeah, chime in.
What do you think?
Chime in on Reyna's death.
What did you think about Reyna's death, redemption?
And Jai Ying's betrayal.
And Jai Ying's, I don't know why I felt like it was Scottish. We're gonna go. Keyla, go ahead.
I am overall really surprised that they let Reyna go, although I guess they were kind of setting it up for the season. She finally found out what she became, and she kind of sort of just found her people and definitely sacrificed herself for something she believed in. And if she didn't believe in her sacrifice and in her gift and like what she had become, then she would have never sacrificed herself. And I think she knew it was inevitable, but it's really sad to see her go. Such a beautiful character. And I hope she does come back. But before I even mention that again, Jai Yang's death that was the entire scene when Kyle MacLachlan came up and said, it's like, you don't have to do this. And he kills his wife. That was so sad. And I have to admit, I did cry a lot. But they definitely did pull on the heartstrings. And I'm really looking forward to next season, especially with the end of this episode. We saw Kyle Goggin went through Tahiti protocol, and he just, you know, has a clean slate. So I wonder if that's going to, his memory is slowly going to come back, and he's going to remember about Jai Yang. He's going to remember about Sky. The thing with Reyna, though, she has such a great arc this season, and I'm in denial that she is completely gone. So, do you guys think that Reyna is actually dead? Do you think that she'll come back some way, somehow, in future seasons? Because I would really, really like to see that.
That's an interesting point, actually. We had the Reyna's body, like, technically being dragged off,
mm-hmm.
but we never saw of it being disposed or anything like that. Maybe she has. Maybe they have an ability to bring her back to life.
But
I don't think
it's
going to happen.
She's dead, and I think she knew she was going to die.
Yeah.
She knew it was the end.
I think that primetime network television, I don't want to see the, well, let's get rid of this body scene. Yip-a-doo.
It's just like, you never want to see that. I know.
On board with that.
The reason I'm thinking of it that way is because she said that we're not going to speak again.
Yeah.
We're not going to speak again. And Jai Ying sliced her throat.
Mm-hmm.
She could have easily, like sliced her vocal cords in a way where she's not able to speak. So she's an oracle, she's a clairvoyant that can't speak. And that would be a really interesting transition for her character if she were to be turned into, you know, like, a guest star part.
So she's on another show.
Right, she's been cast on another show. So they could bring her back occasionally as something like that.
Recurring. But, yeah, no, I kind of think she's going to... It was Jai Ying that I thought maybe... she's the one that can't seem to die.
Well,
like,
yeah, she
afraid,
could possibly
but I kind of want her to be dead.
But
I'm done with her.
Like, she... I really dislike her.
She didn't die because Cal brought her people to siphon life out of. If they know that, and then they just go like, no, you get no people, like, she can't, like, she doesn't come
back.
Oh,
that's true. That's true.
She's not she doesn't heal, she steals the life force from people.
Right,
she
exactly.
Heal.
Which was so evil of her.
And her own daughter.
She tried to kill her own daughter.
That's
like
messed up.
She weird. She crazy.
It just got really, it got really dark. Yeah, Skye's family is just so...
And poor Skye, like, I know. She's already so scarred, and now her mother just tried to kill her, the mother she'd been trying to find.
To look for so long. Yeah, that was, like,
emotional roller coaster of Skye's life.
It is interesting that you guys mentioned Skye's family, because the next thing I want to talk about is her dad.
Yeah.
We got to see Mr. Hyde.
Okay.
And we also got to see some of the best acting that I've seen all season. Because...
Absolutely.
Come on, so Kyle MacLachlan.
Kyle MacLachlan, you freaking rocked it.
Yeah. Really good. And remember, we had talked in an earlier episode about how, like, he was over the top sometimes.
Yeah.
But it worked for the character, but it was fine. But...
Yeah.
In this scene, like, I cried twice during this episode, and both were his scenes at the end.
It was heart-wrenching.
And it was just because he really brought it back, and then he was so real with his with Skye. And
I love that, don't like, live with that pain, I'll do it.
Oh, yeah.
I'll,
he's like, I love it because it was so, like, he was giving nothing, he was like, don't do it. And you're like, which one is he talking to?
Yeah.
And it was Skye, and he was like, talking to Skye.
You shouldn't live with the pain of killing your own mother.
And it was, he had just given, like, readied himself for this horrible thing he had to do for, and,
there was just, it was like, all these surreal moments, or unreal moments, grounded in such reality for both those characters, and, like, I genuinely felt that familial bond between them, and in the end, you know, when they, like, Tahiti project him, and she just goes and see him, and he's, like, a vet, I'm like... That's so heartbreaking. Well, like, I cried.
But he looks so happy and normal.
He does. And it's so weird. It's like...
Yeah. Family's not a family without a pet.
there's also the thing that... We've seen the Tahiti project go wrong. So, like, obviously, they still leave the window open for him to come back in and kind of remember everything.
Oh, yeah. And he's still, you know, Jekyll Hyde. You know?
Like, yeah, right, exactly. Hyde, like, is there going to be something inside of him that can pop out? He's still got the powers. He was still really strong, even if he wasn't taking the serum. So, that play into his veterinary life and his shenanigans. Right.
Suddenly he's the only dude who can give, like, suppositories to rhinos. He's just like, sit down! Sit down! Shove it in!
Oh my God.
I'm a doctor. That was the dumbest thing I think I've ever said. I've said a lot of really dumb stuff. I'm gonna say runaways and move on.
In all honesty, though, like, even I thought that he was the breakout part of this entire season.
Yeah.
Like, Cal was one of the best characters. He was one of the most well-rounded characters in the whole season. Like, we got to introduce him as a villain, and suddenly we just really feel for his cause and everything that he's gone through.
Well, and it was a really powerful cause. Like, he had a great arc where he was just, like, he just wanted
his family.
He really, like, it was all based, like, it was all heart.
Yeah.
And he realizes it for himself that it's his love for his family that turned him into a monster and trying to protect his own family. He says that.
Because the lengths he would go to do it.
Speaking of the monster aspect, Mr. Hyde. Reactions? Thoughts? Mark? I want
you
to
know
start
what?
With you.
I know you guys, like, you guys, I know, have very polarizing views on it or whatever.
Not necessarily polarizing,
not really.
But
you guys all sort of agreed. It didn't bother me.
Again,
I was just
I'm
like,
with Mark on most things.
Yeah, I was like, I was sort of like fine, and I was kind of like fine with it. And I feel like it was important in the scene where Coulson is talking him down and talking about Skye and how they both, like, have very fatherly, you know, feelings for her. Yeah, and I feel like it was important for that scene that you still saw Cal's face, like
that's
it was
true.
Still him.
That is
you
really
know?
True.
And so,
and I think it was
like it worked. And also, I mean, budget wise,
it's just
they're not going to be able to do what they do for the Hulk in the Avengers movies as they do for the TV show.
And I think also it was an attempt to ground it a little bit more.
I know what you mean.
Like, you know, like,
well, ground it. You living in a universe where there's like a god from another from another universe,
but
or
I
from
think
like
that's
another
one of the things
galaxy.
The show has been doing a lot of, though, is like, even though Lady Sif and the Kree showed up, the show keeps it a little more. It's not as
they're trying
extravagant
to keep it
as the films.
That's the okay. So that's a completely different debate, and that, like, we don't really need to get into. The only thing that scares me from that aspect is that, like, if they create such completely different tones for all the different shows, are they going to feel like they're actually living in the same
connected
world? Yeah, that's kind of what worries me. But that aside, because I think they're still doing a great job. That aside, I thought that the execution of Mr. Hyde as a character wasn't necessarily great, because it was still Cal, just completely Cal the entire time. Mm-hmm. I didn't really see a change in his character. It was just like, yeah, he was a little more violent, and he was a lot sillier. Like the whole gorilla testosterone that he's like injected himself with, and all these like masculine amphetamines or whatever.
With a little bit of
hint
peppermint.
Of peppermint.
Hint of peppermint. What? I thought that was great. The recipe was phenomenal. But so I was expecting him to turn into like a massive, brooding, hulking beast or something like that. And it just, he takes the extra adrenaline, he falls over, gets up, he's like, oh, that was my missing ingredient. I'm like, you've worked this formula for the past 20 years. Yeah, he grew his fingernails, and like his head kind of bulged out, and like his jaw a little bit.
It was pretty traditional to like the original, Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde sort of character, where it's him just... sort of a little bit more
just
grotesque.
Turning a little more twisted.
Yeah.
And I saw that. Like, it was a little more grotesque, but it was also kind of silly, I thought, that he didn't seem like the kind of person that can really easily tear apart like 100 men or something like that. Does that make sense? Because he wasn't
physically imposing, really, is what
you're
saying.
Right, he wasn't physically imposing, like, when he was attacking the rest of the agents.
They don't necessarily have to look it to have the strength.
I know what you mean, but he wasn't very good with the execution of his actions. Like, he throws something, but he completely misses. He's just chasing them. He's intimidating them. But there's no, like, actual... There wasn't a single moment where I was scared of this character and saying, like, oh, he's a monster. He can, like, rip somebody to shreds. He didn't kill anybody.
And he didn't seem out of control.
No, that's what I wanted to see. That's, like, about... That's
but
not
I think,
about Mr. Hyde is the...
Yeah,
really interesting.
But I think that... I mean, we find out that all of those agents and that village that he killed...
Yeah.
What I don't think...
Well, he just sacrificed them to Jai Ying.
Yeah, he just brought them to her. I don't think he is a monster.
He's killed a lot of people, though. Like,
yeah,
he's torn them apart and stuff like that. That's what happened,
true.
Like, in his when we first got introduced to him. That's why. That, like, I was expecting him to be a lot more terrifying as Mr. Hyde once he turned into it. It was just kind of silly. You know, he was chasing them around, and all they needed to do was just, like, lock him in that same spot, you know, with the jack or whatever it is, the...
I loved Simmons' judginess of his ingredients. Like, she was just like, that's really ridiculous. like, this should kill a man.
But he didn't die.
Just to speak really quickly to your, the shows and movies having different tones and still connecting, I think it still works because I feel like also, like, in our world that we existed right now, I mean, it's like... It's a very different tone in, like, a residential suburban neighborhood than it is, you know, on Skid Row downtown.
Right.
You know, like, I feel like different neighborhoods in different parts of the world have different tones.
Agreed.
And different parts of the universe for Guardians of the Galaxy, maybe.
Ooh.
But, like, they can have different tones and still, I think, work because it's people come from different...
That's a really good point.
So I feel like that can be skewed around. I just want to speak to that very quickly.
That's a really good point. The only reason I see it as like still kind of strange is because these are people that have been and seen a lot of shit.
Right.
But they still spend a lot of time, you know, throwing in one-liners and stuff like that and being like totally chill about it. Whereas, for example, in something like Daredevil, where he still goes through something that's just as substantial as a betrayal of a mother or something like that, like, just as monstrous situations, it is really, really dark.
Mm-hmm.
Regardless.
Yeah.
Although he still makes jokes.
Daredevil made jokes. Like,
yeah, they did.
And when they did, they were usually really funny because it
really
was coming from such a dark place.
Yeah. Keyla, half an hour ago, we started talking about Mr. Hyde. What did you think of Mr. Hyde in this episode?
Anything to add?
Seeing Mr. Hyde in his full form and stuff, I was a tad disappointed because I was expecting something a lot grander and larger in scale. And I was live tweeting that night while watching the episode, and a lot of people were really freaking out because right when we saw his hand come up on the bed and then it went to commercial... everyone was just like, yes, it's finally happening. We're finally going to see Cal become Mr. Hyde. And then when we came back and he was just like, still kept his like form in a way, but just got a little bit larger, like a little bit muscular, and his head got a little bigger as well. Like I was a little disappointed. I was disappointed, but I accepted it afterwards because the conversation that, Cal had with Coulson while he was pinned to the car was so sad. So heartbreaking, because that's when we discover the truth, and although we've kind of guessed it a little while, But that's when we discover the truth that Jiang is a true monster, and that Cal just did as her bidding, like just to please his wife and to do and to keep her alive and stuff. And that was a heartbreaking just realization in his eyes. I was like, oh my God, I have to help these people stop what she's doing. It's wrong. And I did cry. It was sad. Overall, I was mad at first when I saw Mr. Hyde wasn't as large as I wanted him to be, but I accepted it afterwards because I think Kyle MacLachlan just sold me on the transformation and after the fact, because he's just a fantastic actor. And I hope he does show up sometime during season two, even after the end of this season finale where we saw him at.
So we're pretty split.
It's not necessarily a split. It's more so there's a few gripes with the way that he looked. He could have looked better. I think that the physicality could have been a little better.
But like Keyla said, Kyle MacLachlan's performance
won over. It was just so good.
So you forget about it and you're fine. Yeah. All right. Next.
Next. He's like, I'm going to get through this. All right. This. Boom. Ward.
Stand with Ward.
They said it. Hey, guys, they said it.
They said it.
After it became fully clear that he is full on evil.
The question for me is, do you guys think that they used it really well, or do you think that it was more so ironic, sarcastic?
Like a slap in the face. Oh, you're going to stand with Ward? Well, you're standing with the villain.
Because they kept him super evil, super dark, and now he's turning into the new head of Hydra.
I loved it. He's so much more interesting evil.
Here's
yeah, but I also hate him now. I was like, this is interesting. There's going to be a twist. There's going to be a turn. Something's going
to
happen.
I actually am now starting to like him because it's more of an interesting
character.
He's
sticking to his guns.
Yeah, I didn't find him as interesting before.
I was having a conversation with somebody online this week.
Don't lie to us.
And
was it just you?
It was my mother. And she said, Kevin, why? No.
I don't understand this.
What is a TV? My mom's apparently Amish, I guess. But we were talking about the fact that Spike on Buffy starts as a villain and then ends up, by the time you get to the fifth season of Angel, being one of my favorite characters. I love Spike. I think Spike's awesome.
But he was always very endearing, regardless of whether he was a villain or a good guy. He was always very endearing.
Very charming.
He had this sassy, charming kind of attitude, and that's what always worked. He had that Billy Idol style look, and then being a punk
and what I was saying when we were talking about that took many
seasons.
Yeah. And that could happen with Ward.
We could, What I think is that, I mean, they're going full bad guy with him.
Oh, sure. Yeah, and he's a great villain.
He's a great villain.
Yeah, I really enjoy it.
And his motivations are so interesting to me because we've theorized, is he Hellfire? Is he Taskmaster?
I don't think he's any of
those. I think if he's anything, he's Taskmaster. But at this point, he's just Ward.
He's just Grant
himself.
Ward.
And I think that's a really strong choice to make because you've now just built yourself a villain instead of popping one into a show. You've been like, this is a guy that's been on the ride with you the whole time. And now we get to see him in a big villain point that's not him riding on the fact that, oh, he turned into this person.
It's a change in his arc.
It's him riding him. Yeah.
I just thought it was so interesting, his shift, and he's just brutal. He's just brutal. He's turned himself pretty much into a monster. I guess his relationship with 33 was real. It was authentic.
Yeah.
Because he did seem upset by
God, when he killed her, he was distraught. He was so messed up inside.
Which, that kind of threw me a little bit, because I never believed that
he really loved
did.
Her. It was
Except
too soon.
That, I mean, she was as fucked up as he was, sort of, because
it was
kind of
like
happened to her.
It was just like a dark Bonnie and Clyde kind of situation that went on, where he ended up killing his own Bonnie. But he's from the moment that I just saw him stick those needles right into
we were not fans of
Mark
that
and
scene.
I were not.
I could so disturbing.
And why did they keep showing it
for that
just
reaction?
To show that he has no ethical qualms with,
yeah,
with
he's crossed
what
the
he
line.
Has to do. He's crossed that line. He is full monster in this case. And he's like, I'm going to take over Hydra. This is it. But it's so messed up because it's so Freudian. It's so like linked with his idea and his notion of family. He's constantly seeking a family. And that's what he's trying to do. He's like,
because
yeah,
he
I don't
says,
wanna,
he's like, I want to, I'm tired.
I'm tired of flying
wanna,
solo.
I want a team.
Mm-hmm. Tired of flying solo.
But he wants to lead the team.
Right.
Exactly.
So here's our first question from the Twitter box. At Skyber21 asks, is Ward the new leader of Hydra or what? And this was a conversation we were having because obviously he's hunting down Hydra leaders at the end and their Hail Hydra is said. Is he officially trying to take over Hydra or is he forming his own? Like, I was looking up, because obviously I know Chaos from
right
other things
yeah.
that aren't Marvel related, but from Get Smart, but I was like, is there a Chaos in Marvel that I don't know about? And he's a galactic entity, so
yeah.
no.
Yeah, I don't think he's going to be
No,
bad.
He's not bad.
Yeah.
But do you guys think he's heading Hydra, he's just stealing from Hydra because they're people he knows, or...
Well, I feel like the smart thing would be, I mean, to take over Hydra because... There's so many Hydra people still out there.
True.
Yeah.
And they're like, oh, we have a new leader. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And they are still Hail Hydra. So then he would have a huge
yeah.
See, what
thing.
What I
so
think
as opposed to making his own thing with him and like three, like,
those
random
three dudes.
Hydra
See,
dudes.
Random
yeah.
dudes. One that's
yeah.
covered in tattoos. Frank
Cherry
like,
and Tattoo Bill.
Yeah.
yeah.
Like,
Hazard.
yeah. Like, this can't be his team, but I can't take him seriously. But I feel like the situation, the way that it ended, very much mirrored where S.H.I.E.L.D. was after the fall, that they split into our team that we had, and then the real
oh, right.
S.H.I.E.L.D. or something like, that.
Like that.
I mean, looking at the Marvel Cinematic Universe moving forward with Civil War, they're still going to... Hydra's going to still be a threat, and one of the main leaders is going to be Baron Zemo,
mm-hmm.
right? He's a major bad guy, major head of Hydra. So it feels like they're kind of going to go in that direction where there's going to be the real Hydra that's probably with Baron Zemo, and then the offshoot of Hydra, which is going to be Grant Ward running his Hydra rebels, if you will,
mm-hmm.
hunting after S.H.I.E.L.D. and such. So, and it's very interesting to see that, like, S.H.I.E.L.D. rebuilds itself while Hydra crumbles and kind of mirrors the same thing that it happened.
The other way around,
when
yeah.
they
right.
used to be one singular entity in the past. So, I'm just really interested in seeing how they'll move forward
yeah.
with that.
Keyla, as our resident Wardite,
yes.
what did you think of him in this episode and where he is going forward?
I was overall really disappointed with the decision of making Ward into the villain. I was really looking forward to a Ward redemption arc all throughout the season, and I felt like they were kind of sort of finally setting up for that, and I was okay with Ward being labeled as the anti-hero, and that's how I wanted him to be, but the fact that Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., the show, decided to mark him as the villain at that very bit, last bit of the episode, so we definitely can look to see next season for him to be in that leadership villain role, and I just feel like that's a cop-out to his character, because his character, he's such a dynamic character, such a great character, you can go so many other places with him than that. It was dumb, and I thought it was complete, excuse my language, bullshit what it did with his character. I thought it was really great of S.H.I.E.L.D. of the show to say the line, stand with Ward, kind of like a nod to the fans online, the Ward's Warriors online, and then at the end for them to kill Agent 33, for Ward to kill Agent 33, and then Ward go to Hydra and now become in that leadership role as that we're all expecting him to be now, it kind of like diminishes the whole great feeling and moment of them saying stand with Ward. It kind of just takes that entire moment away like it didn't even matter. Which really sucks, especially for the fans online. A lot of people are still very mad about that. But I will always be a Ward fan. I'm really looking forward to what they're going to do with him next season. And I hope, just like I think you guys mentioned Spike from Buffy and stuff, it took a lot of seasons for Spike to finally get his redemption and stuff. I think it was like season 4 of Buffy where he finally started turning around. So yeah, if I have to wait that long for Ward to turn around for us to have a war redemption, then I'll wait that long. It just sucks that it didn't happen now.
I'm torn that way because I think I love Ward as a villain, so yeah. I'm glad he's staying on because I think he's a great villain. Also, I think he could have a really great death scene. I know. It could be really powerful.
One of the things takes like 100 shots before he goes down.
Like, or like, you know, like Baron Zemo, somebody that comes up behind him just squares his hands and like, hey, I'm here now to run things.
They have killed a lot of people really easily like that. I mean, Reyna died like that. A lot of people died like that.
I think one of the things that I'm most intrigued about is a villain who knows them. Like, they've been just going up against... I'm going up against Hydra. I'm going up against the Inhumans who don't like S.H.I.E.L.D. This is a personal vendetta, and those make the best villains for me. Yeah. The one who goes like, you know what? I know you. I know what you stand for. I know how to hurt. Like, he knew...
And you don't stand for war, so I'm gonna kill you.
He knew that watching Hunter die would be what kills Bobby. And so he was like, that's what we're doing then. Like, I'm excited for that. I realized that while Kayla was talking, and
he's
I got real
a dirty
excited.
Player. Yeah.
Like, yeah, I was like, ooh, I got like Runaways excited, guys.
Nothing
as exciting as the Runaways.
I think that's really cool. I'm interested in seeing him run this offshoot of Hydra, and I would really like in the mid-season finale of season 3 for Whitehall to still be alive, show up, and like kill him or something like that, or make him his bitch. Something. I think that would be really interesting, and it's like
sounds good to me. Well, all
right, that's a different kind of fan fiction, guys. For after midnight. he's like, what the fuck?
I'm a delicate flower.
Give us a transition. Okay. What's the next topic?
Give us a transition.
Forced transition. Let's talk about the battle on the aircraft carrier.
Oh my god, that was insane.
So a lot of stuff happened. Everybody dead. We had Fitz.
Including Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D. number
Fitz
one.
Fitz fighting in the field was
Fitz
awesome.
And also, Fitz seems to have his stuff back. Like, he's back to what he's finishing Hunter.
His brain is back in action.
Makes me so happy.
I know.
Yeah.
I thought he was dead, and I vomited everywhere. Like when
I
Gordon,
had to clean my couch.
When Gordon pops up behind
the pallet afterwards, because it was
when
just
Gordon behind him, and you see the pipe, and it looks like it's through him. I thought maybe Gordon had done that teleporting thing like Vision does, where he like solidifies inside of the body and just kills him. And I was like, what just happened? What just
happened?
But
then the camera comes around, and it's Gordon. I was like, oh. Thank you.
Very stressful.
So
Gordon's
I was actually really happy
and
that
I was
Gordon's
glad
dead.
Gordon's dead. I was so sick of the CGI on his eyes.
I was really hoping that he was being manipulated by the end of the last episode, but suddenly he just turns into a dickbag.
It's science, biatch.
That I loved. Who are you? I'm Gordon. And you? I'm the guy that kills Gordon. Gordon. Yeah. Like, Max totally redeemed. Gordon. I may be a totally fickle TV watcher, but Mac totally redeemed. Absolutely redeemed.
You're very wishy-washy with Mac.
I love him. He's fixing Fitz. Oh, he's a jerk bag. He's with the real S.H.I.E.L.D. Oh, he had a cool line. I'm back on board. I don't care.
I actually always like him as a character, even when he goes back and forth. He's a nice character.
It's going to be really interesting moving forward. Nice to watch. He's grounded himself as a member of the team now.
Yeah.
He's taking care of the artifacts.
He's the next one to die. I'm just kidding.
Actually,
I'm hoping it's
likely,
not, actually.
But I hope not.
I like having as many people.
There was so much that happened on that, and it was a great final battle for the season.
Yeah.
And then the showdown between Skye and her mom and Cal came in, and we already talked about that. And just, oh, there was so much. And then Coulson loses his hand.
That was another Star Wars reference, baby.
And a recurring theme in every Marvel project happening
right now.
Phase 2
has just been that constantly.
Go through it.
Okay, so Phase 2 being their Empire Strikes Back, in which, spoilers if you
haven't seen the movie,
Luke loses his hand. Somebody has lost an arm in every Phase 2 movie. Iron Man 3, he cuts off Killian's arm. Thor 2, we get the hand cut.
Thor's hand.
Hopefully you guys have seen
fake
these movies. Cap Winter Soldier is based around a dude who lost his
Bucky's
arm. Let's see. Groot gets his arms cut off by Gamora in Guardians of the Galaxy.
Age of Ultron.
Age of Ultron.
Claw. Ulysses Claw.
And then and then here, and then who's getting their hands chopped off an Ant-Man?
I know. I'm so excited for this. Michael Douglas.
What if it's a Star Wars toy or something like that?
That would be the best, like a little tiny
Star Wars toy just fighting there with the train and just like, oh, he lost his arm. No.
Oh my god, that would be perfect for that.
I just got really excited.
I'm so excited for Ant-Man.
So it was an amazing and Lincoln coming through and being like, I'm awesome too, and May's like, I can fight a bunch of people.
He used his powers. Mm-hmm. I was really enthralled by how they decided the Inhumans use their powers, mm-hmm. and just like show them, and the fact that, you know, like Lincoln shows how his electric powers work, yeah. so badass, and
very
you have
cool.
the other one who just makes multiple yeah. copies of herself. She was really interesting.
And you had that one that fires a gun. He was really good.
Yeah, he was very good at firing a gun. Yeah, I was like, what happened to this guy? He was like, we don't have enough money in the budget.
There were so many randos that died too. Like random on both sides. Like the
so many dead shield agents
and the shield agents.
Beardy McBeardman.
All the
Beardy McBeardman red shirts.
Like, so many red Star shirts. Trek red shirts came back.
Oh my god, I love that reference.
But yeah, no, it was really great. Like the way that they used the Inhuman mm-hmm. powers were really badass, and I'm freaking excited about what the future is going to be for them.
Exactly, because the fallout is my favorite, because you've got the new team that Coulson's building.
Well,
right?
And now what's going to happen to Lincoln, I'm wondering. Because
yeah.
I'm so glad he turned, because I actually didn't like it when he was doing all the bad guy stuff.
He was just so manipulated.
And I didn't really believe him.
Yeah, he's like, you have a mind of your own, you should be able to.
Yeah, he seemed dumb when he was being, yeah.
So a question that was raised on the Twitter box.
I have a feeling I know what it is, but you go.
Okay. This one comes from @FantasiaWise1, and Fantasia asks us, what do you think Sky is in charge of, and can season 3 come any quicker?
Okay. So I'm like super fucking excited for this.
Okay, you're super fucking excited for I just edited myself. for everything that happened. Like, anytime someone's like, maybe this is happening, you're just like, this bundle of history.
But dude, like,
so,
it's totally gonna be Secret Warriors. It's totally gonna be Secret Warriors, and that's gonna be the most amazing.
I think it's gonna be Secret Oreos. I don't know what that was.
I don't know what that is.
But, it's absolutely Secret Warriors. Daisy in the comics. This is my turn. Daisy in the comics in Secret Warriors was the leader of the secret team of a bunch of people that Nick Fury had put together after Hydra and Civil War and all that. That's where the Hydra was S.H.I.E.L.D. storyline in the comics came from.
Right.
And so now that they've got Daisy in place to lead a team of powered people... That's what it's going to be.
It's
got to
be
Secret
great
Warriors.
Link. Yeah. I would be very interested to see if, like, these Secret Warriors are the ones that end up causing the accident abroad, in a way. Because they had, like, the televised show. In Civil War, the televised show that they were doing, you know, they were going to these neighborhoods and they dealt with somebody.
I don't think so.
They
I
should
think...
not have dealt with because their powers
weren't good enough,
exactly. And so it just destroys everything. I mean, and then what was his name? I forgot the character's name. He's like a speedster.
Speedball.
Speedball, right. And then he turns into Penance. And I'd love to see that arc happen. It would be amazing. But
they're
going to
need their own show.
But that's
I don't think so,
because the movie then is relying a lot on the television show.
That would be awesome.
It would be cool,
would be
but
really
I don't
great.
Think it's going
to
happen.
They don't
seem
they can just
and like based on my remarks that I made last episode, I don't think that's going to happen.
Yeah.
But it would be great if they could just like ground these two in the same
That'd
world
be very cool.
and bring the Secret Warriors into the movies eventually.
Would be really cool. Keyla, what do you think of the fight on the aircraft carrier and the possibility that Sky is now leading Secret Warriors?
Mm-hmm.
I thought the stunt choreography for the entire fight scene against the Inhumans and S.H.I.E.L.D. was really on point. I really enjoyed Sky. I feel like Sky's fight scenes has been fantastic this season. And in this particular episode when she was fighting the redhead who duplicates herself, that was a really great scene, especially for the fact that, like, I felt like the camera movements were following her for certain, like, punches and, like, movements, and it made for that fight to be even more epic. So I really, really enjoyed that fight. I think, as you guys mentioned, like, Fitz and his, like, science biatch, like, that was hilarious. It was a great moment in the fight as well. You know, Gordon against Mac, Fitz, and Coulson. It was hilarious, fantastic to see. And it really great to see Lincoln's powers, too, in, like, true Lincoln-esque inhuman power mode. It was nice. It was really nice to see. I'm hoping he joins the team that Sky is now leading, which we saw at the end of the episode. And I really felt like there it's most like 100% Secret Warriors, especially because when she was talking to Coulson, she was like, we can't be like the Avengers. We can't be out and open. We have to be secret. We have to be, and then like he cuts her off. Like it's definitely like setting out for a Secret Warriors. I'm very excited for that. I hope Lincoln joins that team. I don't know if like Lincoln can't because maybe he has to take care of the Inhumans from Afterlife still, if they're going to go back to that in season 3. I don't know. But stunt choreography, fight scenes in season finale Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. was really, really great. I can't wait to see Sky in that leadership role. And I'm excited to see both teams. I can't, like, act with each other. We're going to have a superhero team, like, on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. being Secret Warriors, which we're all guessing. And we're going to have S.H.I.E.L.D., you know, Bobby Hunter, if they come back, and Mac and Coulson fighting. So a team up maybe, or like two separate teams. I'm excited to see that like dynamic next season. It's going to be really fun. And going to make for a really great season 3. I'm really looking forward to it.
I said that to you guys right after we watched it, where she went, we have to be, and he cut her off, and I was like, you jerk. You knew we wanted to hear it.
Anonymous. Should have said secret.
I know.
It's just so good though.
I think we have to end on one of my favorite moments into one of my least favorite moments on the show, Fitzsimmons.
Yes.
They had the moments, and maybe we should talk about it. And he was like, I gotta go fight. And then
it's like, now? You're asking me this now?
And then I was like,
but then when he realized what she was at, he was like, oh.
Oh, okay. Fight can wait.
And then we get our tag.
Oh, shit,
where
man.
The Kree Stone absorbs Simmons. Now, we know that she's not dead. She's not dead.
Yeah, she's
signed
she's
up
coming
for
back.
Season 3.
Yeah. So.
But literally, I'm trying to figure out how every season can end with one of the two of them being
separated,
like, separated and injured.
Or somehow impaired in some way.
Right.
Take a whole season and bring
yeah.
them back.
Because
it's the old Sam and Diane from Cheers.
Like, oh my god.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, let's also
just keep it going for as many seasons
because,
as we can.
Yeah, because we have.
Keep them apart.
The big question, and this
it
comes from
it's
the
also,
Twitter box.
But it's the whole thing, the whole relationship that they have is also very Buffy. Sorry. Very Buffy Angel.
Slowly put the Twitter box down.
She crossed over to another dimension, and now they have to cross over to that dimension and get her back. It's very much like Angel.
Yeah.
And what
I can't wait to see
Angel.
Where she is.
That's a good question. I hope it's in the Twitter box.
That's why I wanted to speak it out.
At New Moby asks us, any theories on what happens to Gemma or will happen after she resurfaces from the Kree object?
Mm.
So it seems like a big part of the beginning of next season is going to be figuring out where she is and getting her back.
Yeah.
This, I was thinking about this while we were talking. This is the only way I could foresee possibly Reyna coming back is if it's another dimension and she's possibly like her
you
spirit
mean like a
is there.
Universe, or you mean another dimension, like, oh yeah, where her spirit
like
is.
Immediately, like, even though the Kree are not connected in any way, my brain always, when someone gets kidnapped in Marvel, for some reason, immediately goes to Mephisto's realm. And I know that they're
right
not
to hell, right?
Like,
yeah,
yeah, like, and I know they're not taking her there because why would a Kree bomb take her to Mephisto?
We don't know it's exactly a bomb. We
right,
don't exactly
a Kree
know.
It's monolith.
A Kree artifact.
Yeah.
Yeah, this monolith. It just switches from liquid to solid. But did anyone else have that feeling that it looked like graviton the entire
yes,
time?
Yes, absolutely.
Like, it so like looked like graviton. The way it absorbed her inside.
Yeah, totally.
I don't know if we're going to see her popping out, like the hand, kind of the same way that happened with graviton. Mm-hmm. But what if it brings him back into
the
fold?
Like Star Wars.
Like, that's another Star Wars reference. I think, in this case. That would be great. And that's another Empire Strikes
yeah,
Back
yeah,
comment.
A lot of Empire.
But I wonder if that's a reason why they might need to bring Graviton back into the fold. They might need his help, or they try to explore Gravitonium because it's in liquid form. But it's a solid
because
it's metal.
Because They introduce it at the beginning of season one. Ian Quinn gets it back into season two, and then we get nothing about it. So, and granted, it would have been totally shoehorned into the season. It didn't have a place.
Right.
But this could be an interesting thing that gets us back there.
Yeah, reintroduce it to it.
I also think it's important to note, because of the tragedy of it all, because I didn't even pick up on it until I watched it again.
When I told you,
that
like,
it's Fitz accidentally is the one that unlocks the cage. Just to add to how tragic it is that they're not getting together.
Yeah, because he doesn't have to watch it again.
It's all his fault because there was, it was a little, like,
which means that when she comes back, she's probably going to be super pissed off.
No, I don't think so.
You think I think she's going to come back like a Xena Warrior Princess style. Like,
do you think she'll have powers? Do you think she'll end up getting powers?
I think that would be awesome. I think it would be terrific if she ends up with powers. I have no idea.
I think every season they're slowly going to give...
Do you think there's somebody that she could become from the comic books? It's probably too early to
say. I don't think she's anyone inhuman. I don't think she's anyone who's a mutant. I think if they do turn her into something, they'll just turn her into something of her own. Like, she's going to be a new character. Because they're trying to do a lot of that through the show. However...
It would be interesting, too, if she got powers, considering she was one of the sort of anti-power people.
Right. You know? I don't know.
It was one of the splits with her and Fitz.
See,
and,
what's really interesting, what could be really interesting is if they try to link it at all with Captain Marvel.
That's what I was just doing in my head!
Is that what you were thinking?
Like, because of her, like, she's human and she's got some Kree in there and, like...
Right.
They couldn't, obviously, they're not going to make her Carol, like,
she's not Carol Danvers. She's not Carol Danvers at all, but...
But could she be,
like,
a Miss Marvel?
Yeah.
And then,
like Kamala Khan style, Miss Marvel.
Maybe there's still the spinoff is canceled, but there's still the pilot that the writer of 12 Years a Slave is doing, which could theoretically be Kamala Khan.
Right.
But like, that could be really interesting.
If they bring that into it.
If they made her an almost Miss Marvel like character.
Yeah. It would be really... I think that would be great. Like, if it links into that way. Yeah, because it's all linked with Kree and Skrull.
Yeah.
Even more so with Kree than anything else. For the Captain Marvel and Miss Marvel kind of origins. Well, Miss Marvel is Inhuman, so that would be, like, a nice tie-in for that show if it does spin off. But then you have, like, the whole universal aspect of it.
Yeah.
You know, like, Kree, Skrull, War, all that kind of stuff. Coming into the fold, and maybe Simmons is affected by that in some way, brings over her powers. She has new powers or something to come into.
That could be really interesting.
We shall see.
Keyla, what do you think? What do you think about Gemma possibly having superpowers? Where is she? All of that stuff.
That was really terrible to see that we finally get a little bit of Fitzsimmons action in season two, in the season two finale, and that happens to Simmons at the end of the episode. All of us were freaking out. That tag at the end, they always have to get us with the tags at the end. And I'm really looking forward to what happens to her next season, because if something like, if she changes physically and she becomes something else, or she is actually something else, like an alien, like possesses her or something, I keep wanting and I keep actually thinking of the Fright storyline in Angel. I don't know if you guys know what I'm talking about, but at the last episode in the last season of Angel, Fred becomes Illyria, which is like one of the old ones. And it's not really her, but like it possesses her body and she becomes something else. That'd be really cool if they do kind of the same thing with Simmons next season. Or maybe she comes back with like powers or something. I don't know. And it was just really sucks that it happened right when, like, she was, I think they were going to get dinner, her and Fitz, and I guess we're just going to have to wait quite a while for us to finally get a little bit of Fitzsimmons action, or a little, maybe like a kiss, something, I don't know, but, it's gonna make for some really, really great, episodes in season two. I wonder how long into season two they're going to take to finally get to finally figure out what happened to Simmons, and then get her out of it. I hope it doesn't take too long, because I want to find out what happens to her, what happened to her, and what's going to happen to the team after she gets back. If she's changed at all, like physically with like superpowers, like I was saying, or she becomes something else, or she's possessed by something, alien or Kree, I would want that, and I'm looking forward to what happens. It just sucks that it had to happen. And technically, it was Fitz's fault because he opened, like, the glass cage. So that sucks.
I would be sad if Simmons came back and she was not Simmons, like that her consciousness was somewhere else.
Yeah.
But no, I would just be sad. There would be no.
Well, yeah, and just to prolong Fitz and Simmons not getting together, it'll be a whole season of her not having any memory.
Wouldn't it be great if they got together? Too bad.
Like when the bionic woman got bionics and she came back and then she had no memory and she couldn't marry Steve Austin anymore.
They're just dangling happiness in her face.
Like, they always keep doing this. Like, oh, we'll tease you some more.
What if next season's finale is again, like, oh. If next season's finale is like they kiss and then Fitz just suddenly becomes dust. We gotta go get him.
We gotta fight him. He's alive. He's just like dust. He's dust.
He just gets him. Like transported like through space, like on Star Trek. Like, but it's the Kree. Yeah, like, we're gonna take him.
No, he's like hanging out with fucking Red Skull somewhere on the other side of the universe.
Like, they kiss, but somebody throws the Tesseract in front of him, and he like kisses the Tesseract and is gone. I would hate that. Don't do that.
Don't just touch your shoulder with it briefly. You just see in the corner of the screen while they're making out. They're like, I love
it's
you.
It's just a ward. Like,
it's a total trolling moment. Ward just touching him with the Tesseract. He's like,
oh, I guess I'm gone too. We gotta find him.
Damn it.
Anyway, thank you guys so much.
Thank you guys
for sticking around with us through all that silliness. We have loved the seasons of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and we are excited to come back in the fall for season 3.
Yeah.
Now, we've got all summer. We've got some movies coming out. Jurassic World, Ant-Man. A lot of really great things are coming out this summer. So don't worry. We're not going to leave you high and dry. We've got some plans in the works. Yeah.
Not as geeky as the other things that are coming out this summer, but I will be in Wet Hot American Summer. So not that it needs any publicity, but it'll be on Netflix the end of July. So check me out there, too.
Yeah. Like, we have all sorts of other projects that you can definitely check out if you're needing a Nerd Shout fix. We'll keep doing... there's a lot of Star Wars stuff that I'll be covering while we go, because that's what I do.
We're going to be going to Comic-Con as
we're
well.
We're going to go to San Diego Comic-Con.
And I really want to do some DC stuff, finally.
Yeah, we've been talking about...
I would love to do a series wrap-up on Flash.
Because I got so into that late in the game. So let us know the kind of stuff that you would want us to see, to talk about. Mm-hmm. And thank you to all the people who have been super supportive. There may be something coming where we do a nice thank you. But for right now, we always want to say thank you to @S.H.I.E.L.D. Radio.
There may be something.
There may be.
The guitar in the back is not a clue.
No, not a clue. I'm J.J. Abrams, and that guitar is not a clue. So thank you to @S.H.I.E.L.D. Radio over at helicarrierpodcast.com. Keep talking to them. Keep that conversation going. Yeah. Thank you to our friends at Ward's Warriors. It's a tumultuous time for you, I know. But we'll see what
will
happens.
Will you continue to stand with Ward?
We don't know, but they put it in there. They put it in the show.
I like him better now, so I'm going to join Ward's Warriors.
And thank you to our friends over at Pop Cults. Check them out at Pop Cults on Twitter. They've been really, really cool, and they've got some awesome stuff that they talk about. And thank you to each and every one of you for being here, for watching, for liking, for commenting, for tweeting, for putting up with everything that we do.
The delays and everything that we have to do. We edit, we shoot, we do everything ourselves.
We're super excited to get Keyla back in the state, hopefully soon. So that'll be great. But for right now, even though we may not be here in a week, our this noise can transcend time and space.
Yes.
So remember, we want to hear your nerd show. We harmonized as crappily as possible. Thank you, guys. Have a great summer. We'll see you very, very soon.
Bye-bye.